No sé si en Carrefour, así que te comes, que no sabes.
Quizás para el Carrefour. Good evening. Come on in. And thank you for coming. I'm Dennis de Blasio. I run the jazz program. I run the festival. Woody!
I made it.
Keith. Oh my gosh, everybody. My girlfriend. Everybody's here. Oh gosh. Come on in. Come on in. It's free giveaways. Get your Tupperware. It's good. Anyway, thank you for showing up, and it's always an honor to play for you. We know you could do a million different things, and we're really happy you came here. This is the end of a three-day jazz festival where we've had high school bands, middle school bands come in Wednesday, Thursday, today, and we worked with them, and we had all our jazz faculty help them, and it's a thing we do every year, and it's really great. So we're always having a lot of fun. And this year, our guest is Doug Beach, who's a great friend of mine who works out in Chicago. He has a festival like this. And I've done his festival about, I don't know, 10 times maybe. And he's now retired, so he's able to do festivals. So this is the first time we have him here, so this is great. And we've been having a ball. Students love him. It's great. It's a big love fest, and with swing music in the background. So it's grabbing a ball. So one of the things we wanted to do when we were talking about what kind of festival we were doing, we thought, you know, Tony Bennett passed, and we figured we would do a tribute to Tony in a different way. We're not going to sing his tunes. That would be a real mistake if I had to sing. We decided that what we would do is we would play a lot of the songs that he recorded. And he recorded a lot of the tunes that were in the Great American Songbook, we call it, you know, Cole Porter, Oscar Hammerstein, all that great music, he recorded it all. So over half of the tunes we're gonna play tonight were tunes that he sang, and Jenny Quinn, who works with us, she created this little visual of just different clips of Tony through his career. And it's interesting about Tony Bennett, he's one of, in fact, okay, that's with Bill Sherlock. I'm trying to think. One of these, there's a photo of a bunch of guys standing with him, and it's when we played him at the Tropicana on New Year's Eve. We took a photo. So if you ever see a photo up there of a bunch of guys that that you wouldn't want to hang out with, that's this gig that we did at the Tropicana, and I'm all the way on the left, and Tony's in the middle. And I don't know where it is, but when it pops up, you'll see it. You'll recognize it because I'm not gray yet, but you'll see it, Tony. So there was a period in Tony's, he was really popular, and then, you know, the British invasion and all that kind of changed music, so people like Sinatra and Tony Bennett, they weren't like the popular music as much as they were before. So Tony, his career sort of slowed down a little bit. And he was still working, but he wasn't the name that he was, you know. And his son, Danny, who has two sons. One has a recording studio in North Jersey in Ankleside Cliffs, I believe it is. And one is, oh man, I don't ever know what to do when I'm in front of these. Like, I know like half of you guys. Okay, so, okay, so anyway, he has a son who's a recording engineer and another one who's a manager. And his son said, look, Dad, let me manage you because I think we can package you in a different way. And he says, well, what do you want me, you know, what do you mean, what do you want me to do? And he says, well, I could put you on MTV. It's when MTV started. And we can have you with these rappers and we can have you with all these different people. And I don't know if you remember, but there was a time when Tony Bennett was actually, he kind of came back and he was on MTV and people were like, what's he doing? Well, there was his son managing him. But Tony said, look, I'll do whatever you want me to do, but I'm not going to sing anything that I don't want to sing. I'm going to sing the music I sing. As long as I sing the music I sing, you can do whatever you want. And his son sort of managed his career back to the point where Tony was starting to be more noticed. And then towards the end of his life, everybody wanted to record with him. You see all these recordings with Lady Gaga, and like you name it, everybody recorded with Tony Bennett, and he became sort of like the elder statesman that he was. So it was really interesting to see how his career went, but He was so good. And when we would play his show in Atlantic City, he sang the same thing every night. Every night was the same order, same tune. He even had the same mannerisms when he would, but every night it got better. It was just better. I remember the guys in the band talking about, how is it that this guy does the same thing every night and it's better, and I don't know why it's better. I can't figure out why it's better. But he had that kind of magic. So anyway, we're going to celebrate him by doing a lot of these tunes that he recorded. Girl Talk, I Left My Heart in San Francisco, a bunch of different things. But so that's the Tony Bennett part. This band, oh, there's Jeff. He's our sound guy. Yes, give it up for Jeff. Jeff. There's one big family here. So it's, so that's pretty much it. And I just wanted to let you know what you're going to see. Now, about not quite a month ago, we had a great group in here, Arturo O'Farrell, who has a great Afro-Cuban group. They play at Birdland up in New York, I think every Tuesday or every Wednesday. It was great. Came in and gave a concert. He has a big band. And the students in the jazz band, the people you're going to hear, they went to see him play, and they really loved it. It was great. It was just great. That music, when you hear that music, it's all about dancing anyway. You're on your feet just moving around. But they really loved it. But the band set up differently. So this setup you see here is different than what we used to set up. This is the way Arturo O'Farrell set up his band. And this is what they call the Kenton Wings in the jazz world. I mean, really, nobody here should care about that. But if you're a jazz educator, there are a lot of different ways you can set up a jazz band. One way is the traditional thing that we've been doing for years, like a box, and there's a reason for it. But Stan Kenton, who had a big band, and sometimes he had a lot of people, he set it up like this, where you have the trumpets, and then they set up with these wings. They call it wings. So since Kenton started it, they just call it Kenton Wings. So Arturo set his band up like that, and the kids saw it, and when we rehearsed, they said, hey, can we try that setup? Because that looked cool. It looked cool. I said, all right. So we set it up, and immediately they loved it. It was all different because you hear things differently. And and I'm not sure if you remember what it sounds like, but in this type of setup, you kind of hear everybody because you don't have a trumpet player sitting behind a trombone player who's sitting behind a sax player, and they're trying to get the bell of the horn out to the crowd. When you set up like this, well, it looks good, but it also sounds different. But to the player, it's a completely different thing. So the person who's sitting here has to play something with the person who's way over there, like 40 feet away. And a lot of times, there's a whole new thing you have to learn. But they loved it, so this is this new setup. So this is the first time we're playing it in concert. So just letting you know a little inside story. So I'm going to go back. I'm going to round these guys up. And I want to thank you for coming out. Thanks so much. And soon we'll start with our tribute to Tony Bennett with Doug Beach. So thank you guys for coming out. We'll have you out of here before it snows. Julian on tenor saxophone. I left my heart in San Francisco, so that was his big hit. You know that. Actually, in San Francisco, outside the hotel where he first sang that, there's actually a statue. So if you type in YouTube, and that's everything's true on YouTube, you can, if you type in Tony Bennett statue in San Francisco, you'll see that he's doing one of these things in front of the hotel. When I walked by, I went, oh my God, there's Tony Bennett. So that was the hotel he first signed the tune in. Whatever. Anyway, we have some great writers up here. Oh, by the way, that arrangement was done by Count Basie originally. That's why it has that Count Basie type feel. We have not only great players, we have some people in the band that write. And they write arrangements and they write original pieces. So we're going to do an original by Trevor Jones back there. Wave, Trev. Thanks, Trev. Yeah. And this is a piece that he wrote, and this is entitled Rain, and this is Trevor's solos in it, because he wrote it. And who else? And Julian. Julian has another solo. They're friends. So, and it features me. Everybody needs a drummer. To do but a bump bump, because it makes everything better. Like, here you go.
Don't do anything.
Boy, I hope it doesn't snow later. See? No reaction. No. Boy, I hope it doesn't snow later. It just makes it. Always carry a tremor with you. It makes everything better. We're going to feature Matt out front, and this is a bass saxophone, what he holds, he's holding right there. And you may not see many of these. You see the baritone saxophone a lot, but the alto, Dan, hold up your alto. this bass saxophone, no, wrong horn. Luke, hold up your tenor. Right. Get out. So this bass saxophone is twice the size of that tenor. That's twice the size. So that's what a bass saxophone is. And a contrabass saxophone is twice the size of a baritone saxophone. And a subcontrabass saxophone is twice the size of that bass saxophone. You're going to forget all this tomorrow. So this is Trevor's composition. This is entitled Rain.
Thank you.
Trevor Jones, composition, Lane, Julian, Trevor, and Matt, bass saxophone. You also might want a bass sax with that drum set. So, for a year, about 40 years, my friend Doug worked out in Elmhurst, a suburb of Chicago. And they had a great jazz festival that was going on forever. He did it for quite a long time, but it happened even before he started. And Chicago's a great place because all the jazz greats went through there. Just like Philadelphia. They go from New York to DC. There's a whole, you play Boston, you play New York, you play Philadelphia, you play Baltimore, you play Washington. It's all lined up. But in the Midwest, if you're north and you're going north or south, you go through Chicago. And almost everybody's played in Chicago. If you're a jazz musician, you've played in Chicago. And the people that played in his, they put out a book, the people that played on his festival, like Cannonball Adderley, that goes all the way back, Dave Brubeck, Maynard, Woody Herman, and his festival was great. And I don't know how he did it, but he somehow finagled money out of somebody, because if we would go to his festival, one night it would be the Buddy Rich Band, and then the next night it would be the Woody Herman Band, and then on the final night it would be the Count Basie Band. So how do you get three big bands to be at your festival? I mean, what back are you robbing that you can pull this off? And he really had, not only is he a great educator, as a lot of people found out the last 3 days, but he's fun, he's a great player, and he writes, he has his own publishing. Well, you're gonna hear some, a lot of his music, but he's a publisher. But he knows how to work it. I've learned a lot from Doug about just how to put things on. And we're talking about fundraising. I said, how do you raise funds? He goes, I mean, you buy a roll of tickets and you sell the band. So what do you mean you sell the band? He goes, you sell tickets, $10 a ticket. If somebody wins the band will come to their house. They'll eat their food and drink their beer, and they'll play at whatever party you have. So if you auction off a big band, all of a sudden everybody wants a big band. So people are buying tickets, like $100 worth of tickets, and you make like $700 in about 15 minutes. I was like, man, I have a lot to learn from you. So please welcome my good friend, Doug Beach.
Good evening, everyone. It's such a joy to be here. We've had a wonderful several days here. It's part of the jazz festival that's going on with high school groups coming in, and spent some time with Denny and these wonderful musicians behind me. It's just been a joy. So just a real pleasure to be here. And we're going to do a few pieces tonight that I had hand in kind of putting together. This next one is a composition I wrote a few years ago, and features some of the soloists of the band. And the name of the tune is Back Alley Shuffle, and I always think it's important that you all know the intricate meanings and the thoughts that go into the titles of these, which Back Alley was a burger place that was nearby where I lived, and it's now closed. But we hope you enjoy the music anyway. This is Back Alley Shuffle.
Thank you.
Back Alley Shuffle, Dan on alto, Christian on trombone, Logan on
jazz bassoon, and Xavier on trumpet, and Doug at composition. Boom.
This next piece we're going to do for you came to me through a guest artist that we had at the Elmhurst Festival quite a number of years ago, the great jazz trumpeter Nicholas Payton, and such a wonderful soloist. And so he had just come out with, I don't think it was his first album, but it was called Gumbo Nouveau, maybe the second one, a great album, and he had some tunes on there. And he didn't have any arrangements for big band, and I wanted him to play with the band and stuff, so I said, send me a couple of lead sheets to some of his music, and I did some arrangements for him to play along with us on. And so that's one of these is what we're going to do next for you. And this is an old, I guess, nursery rhyme, you would call it, called Little Liza Jane. But Nicholas had this great conceptual groove to that he had put to the music, and I just basically adapted that and made a big band chart out of it. So we'll feature a couple of solos in the band. Once again, we hope you'll enjoy this Little Liza Jane. Thank you.
Little Liza Jane, Ethan on alto, Anthony on trumpet, arranger Doug Beach. So here's a standard written by Hoagy Carmichael that Tony, I think he recorded it quite a few times. This is Skylark, and beautiful tune. If you're a jazz musician, you're playing this thing all the time. And there are many great, what we would consider like classic recordings that we study or listen to a lot, where we get the phrasing, and almost every vocalist, Sarah Vaughan, Carmen McRae, Billie Holiday, Ella Fitzgerald, Nancy Wilson, they all sang this tune, and so did Tony. And speaking of Tony, our own Tony, Anthony DiMatteis, wrote this arrangement, and he's featuring himself on it, and this is Anthony's arrangement of Hoagy Carmichael's Skylark.
Thank you.
Anthony DeMatteis.
We're going to do a piece of music next for you that is part of a, I mean, it's not really part of, but there's a lot of tunes that I've written over the years with a good friend of mine in Chicago, George Shutak, and they a lot of them have the title Chili Pepper in them, and they're all Latin-based tunes. And for you to understand a little bit about them, you have to, I guess, know the story of a bit of the history. And so in the 1600s, mid to late 1600s, the great King Poblano was ruling Spain. And he had, like most of the kings did, he had a court composer. And the court composer was one of the favorite meals of the king was chili peppers. And the court composer was forced to write songs about his chili pepper eating and various adventures of the chili pepper over the years. And then all the musicians that were in the court, the jobbing musicians, were forced to buy the chili pepper real book so that they could learn all the tunes and have work in the community and in the kingdom. And to give you an example, like the king's wealth was soaring, and all of a sudden there was the great financial crisis of 1683, and his 401k shrunk to a 101k, and that was the name of Chili Pepper 101. That's how that song came about. And this next one, A Night of the Living Chili Pepper, that we're going to do for you now, was after that, as the economy continued to grow in the kingdom again and came back, and all the musicians were able to work again and work in the evenings, the next song that was written by the court composer was The Night of the Living Chili Pepper, and that's what we're going to play for you now. And if you believe all of this, well, I've got some swampland in Florida I'd be happy to sell you. We hope you enjoy Night of the Living Chili Pepper. Thank you.
Chili Pepper, Doug, Logan, Christian, Ben on drums. Who else? It was somebody else. I forgot. Who else? It was somebody else. Anyway, what's next? Yeah, we don't take a walk with the mic.
Logan, Doug, Christian, Ed.
So this is one that... if you go on Apple Music, whatever, and you type in Essentials, like they have all these playlists already set up for you. You could type in Frank Sinatra Essentials, Steely Dan Essentials, Tony Bennett Essentials, you name it, and they automatically put this list together, and it's called Essentials, usually about 20, 25 tunes that they think you should be listening to. And when you type in Tony Bennett Essentials, this is the second tune. The first one's San Francisco. We already played that. But this is Girl Talk, and this is written by Neil Hefti, a great jazz writer who used to write a lot for Count Basie and some of the great bands. So here's Girl Talk, and this is going to feature Ethan.
Thank you.
Ethan. Ethan, girl talk. So here's something else that Tony recorded. This is just a jazz standard, but Pennies from Heaven. All kinds of versions of this. This is a version from the big band Diva, and we have it. This is going to feature Charles on bass and Matt on baritone saxophone. And you don't get to hear the bass often play the melody. You know, they're stuck playing bass notes. Play some low bass notes, Charles. But the real low money notes, yeah, there you go. That's what you get paid for, the real low ones. So when you hear it, when somebody features the bass, it's a great sound. And the bass should have more melodies. So, yeah, there, yeah.
Good problem for melody bass. That's good. All right, well, here you're going to get some.
Here you go. Pennies from Heaven.
Thank you.
Pennies from Heaven, Matt on baritone saxophone, and Charles on bass.
We'd like to play a piece for you next that was written by Mike Tamaro. I think Mike's been to the festival before here. Gifted musician, wonderful composer. He's the director of jazz studies at Duquesne University in Pittsburgh. And this is a composition he wrote for his first big band album. Very beautiful song. This is called Tears in Her Eyes.
Thank you.
Tears in her eyes, Doug Beach. So we're going to finish up and invite you to our famous meet and greet in the lobby. I believe the fraternity has some jewels. The fraternity has some cheese balls out there, or like dips or Doritos or gummy bears or something. Okay. So and come and meet, talk to Doug. Maybe Matt will bring his baritone sax out there. You could bass saxophone, you let you play it. And or maybe we'll set up the drums and you could just say things. So this tune is something that, another standard. This is Cole Porter tune. This is Love for Sale that Tony Bennett recorded. And so we're doing a couple things here. This is an arrangement that Buddy Rich played. And Buddy Rich played drums in Tommy Dorsey's band when Frank Sinatra was in Tommy Dorsey's band. So all these tunes, they have connections and histories. You could trace almost anything back to anything. But this tune was, when Buddy Rich started his own band, this was one of the great arrangements that he played of Love for Sale. But we're also, as we experiment with this new setup for us, it's different because we, like I said before, this is what they call the Kenton Wings. And in the typical big band style, when they started to play with the different setups, I mean, they came up with all kinds of crazy setups. There's photos of the saxophones, and then the trombones were on top, and then the trumpets were on top, and the drums were on top. Duke Ellington, there's photos of the band almost stacked, you know, like vertically, and they really started to experiment and fool around. Well, one of the things that they did also is, in if you know, the Woody Herman band and the Buddy Rich band and Maynard's band, the trumpets stood. They didn't sit. So we're trying something else. We're going to have the whole band stand just because we want to see what it sounds like because we never had a chance to work in this setup. So we're going to finish up, invite you to join us, and okay, yeah, and meet with us, and we're going to finish up. But how about a hand for our great guest, Doug Beach? Oh.
All right.
So this is the Buddy Rich version of Love for Sale. Love for Sale. So I don't forget, the solos on this are Trevor, wave Trev, Ethan, wave Ethan, and Luke, who you haven't met yet. Wave Luke. Love for Sale, their own university jazz band. Rowan University Jazz Band. Oh, keep, we got a big encore, keep it going.
Go ahead, ready? Thank you very much, Rowan University Jazz Band. Come and see us out in the lobby. The great Tony Bennett. Boom. Doug Beach. Oh, are you kidding?